First of all, we'd like to welcome everybody on behalf of NECAT and SBGrid for coming. I got a whole list of things I have to say. We really need to thank organizers, especially Michelle. She's done so much to get the rooms reserved, everybody's reservation for hotels, and pretty much planning a lot of the stuff here. So we'd like to make sure we thank Michelle. She was at the registration desk. You can go there to register. So students taking course credit, please register at the HMS Curriculum Fellow at the registration desk now if you haven't done so. And then, so for today, we're going to first talk is going to be from Jim Pflugrath, then speech ecotomasi, Kai Dietrich, and then Peter Schliss. In between, there's going to be a discussion session on how to present your data in Table 1. Following lunch, we have a speaker, another talk from Phil Evans' theater talk, and then speech ed, second talk, Kai in one, and then also Matt Kang. 5 o'clock is a poster session and happy hour, followed by dinner. And then just remember that after dinner, the poster session resumes. And then if anybody has any questions for any of the experts, they can ask him at that time. Also, there's the workshops on Saturday, so if you haven't registered before, make sure you do if you're interested. So we have the Phoenix workshop and then the BioLuminate workshop. After the Phoenix workshop, there's also a second, smaller discussion on dials. So if people are interested in that, the limit is 20 people. Let Michelle know. And what else is there? Oh, we make sure we thank the sponsors. So it's Rigaku, Microlytic, Hard Robins, Procure, Dectris, and Mitogen. And those sponsors will also be available during the Meet the Expert session after dinner. So if anybody has any questions, just ask me anytime. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go right into the talks, if that's okay. So first speaker is going to be from Jim Pflugrath, formerly of Rigaku, and so he's going to talk about indexing in 2D dimensional diffraction images. And
thanks everybody. I'm glad to be here. Let me get double mic'd up. Just to get right here. All right. And I didn't realize that you could get course credit for this. Who's taking this for course credit? Anybody? Does that make me a bona fide Harvard professor now? But if I had known people were taking it for course credit, I would have made a harder lecture for you guys. So today, I'm just tasked with talking about diffraction image processing, and in fact, only the first two steps, what people typically call indexing and integration. Now, I realize that the reality is that it's a click-click world, and I could make my talk very short. I could say, just click on the buttons. People don't want to learn how to think anymore. And most of my talk is not specific. Actually, all of my talk is not specific to any particular program. It's to give you some ideas to, once you have your diffraction images, to get through a specific problem of indexing and then integration. And the speaker after me is Bujek Opinovsky. He's going to talk about scaling and merging. I'm going to be here all week. You can ask me questions about all of these topics, anything that you want. I'd be glad to wax eloquently about that. So here's what you've done. What I'm showing here in this slide is there's a crystal here in the center of the diffractometer. X-rays are coming along this collimator here. Will hit your crystal, give rise to Bragg diffraction that will be collected on this Dectris Pilatus 200K detector here. There's a video microscope right here looking at the crystal. This is the crystal shown right here. There's a shutter lamp here. There's a cryogenic gas stream here of nitrogen at about 100 degrees Kelvin. And let's see, this is an experiment I did in my lab. We're going to rotate back to the start of the rotation. The shutter opens, images start pouring out of the detector here going to disk. And in about 26 seconds of total exposure time, This is the experiment we did. We can do SAD phase and dissolve the structure of an egg white lysozyme. Okay, this is a very easy experiment to do in your lab. You don't have to go to a beamline. And you can test how you use your various techniques and so on by doing this. So shutter closed, the data collection is finished. Who has collected data already? I assume most of you have, right? Everybody, almost everybody's collected some data, solved a structure, and so on. So then you know what these steps are. The steps in diffraction data collection and processing is you pick up that crystal that you saw on the previous slide, maybe out of a drop or some interesting apparatus, usually using a loop, or I guess we're sponsored by Mitogen, so we're all using Mitogen. Kapton loops and things. You plunge it into liquid nitrogen to flash cool it, put the crystal on the magnet, on the goniometer head, optically align it, and that might be clicking if you're using a beamline or a robot, but at home you might be using a little tool. You take a diffraction image or two, take an exposure, you look at the images and decide whether to proceed. Remote data collection, whatever, you may just collect all the data and look after the fact. It's kind of like the real ultimate shoot first, ask all your questions later. But if you proceed, you collect the images, you do something called indexing, integration, and scaling, and you get your data. This is the last experiment that you do before you get your model. Everything after this is just massaging the data, I think, as you know. You have some expectations for data quality, completeness, multiplicity, some R factors are measured, R PIM, the average I over sigma resolution. You might want to look at the data quickly to see if there's an anomalous signal to know whether you need to collect data on another crystal or something. You can detect some radiation damage and twinning. This kind of stuff will be talked about later on in the lectures. So once again, you take those initial images, you do indexing, which gives you the unit cell of your crystal and how the crystal is oriented in the laboratory frame. You can do a strategy to calculate how to collect the data, a rotation start, a rotation end, maybe an exposure time, a choice of wavelength. Do the actual data collection, do the processing, look at the statistics, and you confirm your hypothesis for the space group, and so on. For those of you who are going to end up teaching crystallography, I think many of you will, to your colleagues, maybe to your students, when you become Harvard professors yourself, I'm going to recommend George Phillips' X-ray view program. And it shows, for example, a little model of a goniometer with a crystal rotating. This shaded area is a Ewald sphere, which I'll talk about more in a moment. There's a reciprocal lattice centered at the origin of the reciprocal lattice. And as you rotate your crystal, it rotates the reciprocal lattice concomitantly, and it shows the geometry here. So I don't have such sophisticated graphics in my talk, but for you to understand the math behind this, it's good to use a program like that. So here is a sort of a 2D representation of this. There's an Ewald sphere construction here. X-rays are coming in from the left. There's a crystal here, this little hexagon-y kind of thing. This is the origin of the crystal. The red lines are meant to be these reference planes drawn through the crystal here. The radius of the Ewald sphere in my diagram here is 1 over lambda, where lambda is the wavelength. And on the surface of the sphere here, away from the X-ray beam, is the origin of the reciprocal lattice. And I've drawn what I'm going to call the incident beam wave vector going backwards, because I can add vectors, but it's hard for me to subtract vectors. Okay? And so in this construction, this length of this vector is 1 over lambda. It's the radius of the sphere. If we have Bragg's law hold true on a particular set of planes like this, you'll get a diffractive beam wave vector S that goes out, and somehow the photons will hit on a detector here. So the length of S naught is 1 over lambda. The length of S is 1 over lambda. And in this particular construction here, these reference planes, X-rays coming in, angle of reflection equals angle of incidence equals angle of reflection here. What you see here is that this set of planes, the plane going through the origin, will bisect the angle between S naught and S. So there'll be an angle of theta here, an angle of theta here, and the full diffracting angle will be 2 theta. Okay? If I take S plus S naught plus S, I'll get a this vector D star, which is the reciprocal lattice vector. And the Ewald sphere construction is just another way of graphically showing Bragg's law, which is n lambda equals 2d sine theta, where d is the spacing between these red reference planes here, and out of this d star is related to d in a reciprocal relationship. A Bragg reflection is a not a point on the surface of the sphere in real life, but it's a let's call it an ellipsoid. There's various models for it. But how the different programs deal with this depends on the, how the various models are used. And what I'm showing here is trying to fill out part of the reciprocal lattice. Only those reciprocal lattice points that actually intersect the Ewald sphere give rise to diffraction. And I've filled those in, at least on this slide, with filled ellipsoids. Those that are open ellipsoids don't diffract. So as we rotate the crystal, and I'm going to rotate into the vector of rotation axis going into the screen. We'll get a little bit of rotation as they pass through the Ewald sphere. So as it passes through the Ewald sphere, more parts of these reciprocal lattice points will appear. And I'll have several other slides showing that also. In fact, here's a slide that my colleague Mark Prespritz showed last week at the ACA meeting. And what he did here is he's just rotating this reciprocal lattice point till it goes into the Ewald sphere. And you can see that then what we're going to see for diffraction is the intersection of this ellipsoid, this sphere, with this sphere, and give rise to diffraction that our detector hits. Now, if we rotate this picture 90 degrees so that the angle of rotation, the rotation axis is vertical here, I hope you can see that a reflection, a reciprocal lattice point that I've drawn in yellow, no matter how much we rotate this axis, it will go round and around and around, right? And it will never intersect the Ewald sphere, so we'll never collect Bragg diffraction from that reflection. And this is the so-called blind region or the cusp region, which you must be aware of when strategy is being calculated and so on. You can often get you can get from symmetry, and you can see I tilted the rotation axis, the reciprocal lattice principal axes here, so that as you rotate, you can often get a bit into pass through the Ewald sphere. So it's in the old days when you were doing everything by hand and you were thinking and you weren't clicking through things, you had to think about this and make sure you got all the data. Nowadays, at least you should know what the strategy programs are thinking about, and this particular property of the rotation method is, which is the way we collect data. So more math. If we have the X-rays coming in, the scattered beam wave vector going off to here, and put a detector out here, we can actually use this mathematics to determine the unit cell and the crystal orientation. And I'm going to go into that. That's the indexing step. If there was no beam stopping the incident X-rays here, they would hit the detector at, I'll call, the origin of the beam. If a scattered beam wave vector comes up here and hits at point XY, and Y being, in this case, going up and X across, we can actually use these positions to back calculate this vector from the point on the detector all the way back to the crystal. And that will be a vector equal to some scalar T times S. And if we normalize that vector after calculating it, it will give us the vector S. That vector S, if we add S naught to it, gives us a vector D star, which we then have to guess, is it this reflection or this reflection or this reflection, and so on. And mathematically, this linear algebra is what's going on here. S naught plus S equals D star. You can see that graphically. But D star is equal to the Miller index times a matrix B, times a matrix C, times a matrix G, times a matrix R. All of these are 3x3 rotation matrices in 3-space. They're in 3-space. The S vector, I hope you can understand here, is simply a function of the detector position, the rotation angle of the crystal, and the point on the detector X and Y. So the math itself looks like this. To explain what all of these bits and bobs are, The B matrix is a 3x3 crystal orthogonalization matrix. It actually encapsulates the unit cell. Okay? It has, and more appropriately, it encapsulates the reciprocal cell axes, the A star, the B star, the C star. The three angles in real space would be alpha, beta, gamma, but in the program, these are going to be alpha star, beta star, gamma star. And actually, I'm not going to show you what the matrix looks like, but you could look it up. And it looks like a typo here. This is, says don't work on your talk in the morning before breakfast. This is the crystal rotation matrix. It's basically how the crystal is rotated in three space. So if this was a identity matrix with ones along the diagonal, it would be saying like A star is along the X axis in the world frame, B star is along the Y axis, and C star is along the Z axis if you had angles of 90, 90, 90. But basically, knowing what B is and knowing what C is will tell you what the unit cell is and how you're oriented. These things are what you're trying to find out with indexing so that you can then predict where all the spots will be. The G matrix is the goniometer matrix. Do you remember back in the movie I showed you, there was a goniometer that started moving? I didn't show it had a chi and a phi angle, but it was moving omega, and this encapsulates the omega chi and phi, or the omega cap and phi, or whatever it is that you have with your hardware. So you should be able to just look at this from the encoder values of your goniometer and calculate that matrix. The R matrix is a rotation axis matrix, and it's how that crystal was rotating on per image basis. So it you can calculate this matrix also from the hardware, and it could be a general rotation axis. It doesn't have to be around omega or phi. It could be pointed anywhere in space, and the programs know how to deal with this. And you all should know by now what D star, S naught, and S is. Okay. Just a moment, a word on strategy. Deciding what to collect. In the old days, you were thinking about this. You had a choice in your experiment of the distance, the 2 theta, or the swing angle of the detector, where you put the detector. Sometimes you had a choice of wavelength. You have a choice of the overall rotation start and end. You also have a choice of the rotation angle increment. And I think that Clemens is going to talk a little bit about how to choose a good rotation angle increment. I choose it based on spatial overlaps, the kind of detector I have, and a few other things, and I think he'll talk about that. And the exposure time that you give is dependent on expected counting statistics, as well as what you expect for radiation damage. Can you finish up and things? Can you get everything done in time? And I'm not going to go too much into counting statistics here, but I want you to be aware of them so that when you see them the next time, you go, ah, that's what Jim was telling me about. Now I still don't get it, okay? So with Poisson counting, the diffraction is a Poisson counting process. If you have some quantity Q, what this means is that the variance of Q is equal to Q, or the standard deviation of that quantity is equal to the square root of Q. And what that means that is you're measuring intensity from it on a diffractometer, the sigma of the intensity is the square root of the intensity, but. You do have standard error propagation rules going on, so if you have the peak minus the background, the variance of the intensity is the variance of the peak plus the variance of the background. It's kind of like saying if you have A plus B, the variance is the sigma squared of A plus the sigma squared of B, take the square root. Who's done that before in real life? It's like this. I've kind of done it, but I don't remember doing it. But you have done it, okay? All the people who raised their hands and said they had collected data beforehand should raise their hands now. I've done this. All right. In any event, this shows, let's say, a 1D pass as a reflection passes through the Ewald sphere. You'll have some background before it intersects the Ewald sphere. The peak will come up, and then it will disappear. So this is phi rotation. And I'll have several slides here showing that you're estimating this rectangle of background, if you will, by what's on the left-hand side and what's on the right-hand side. Does everybody know the difference between accuracy and precision? Okay, I assume that staring like this means yes, so we'll go on. Accuracy is you have the true value, and precision is how reproducible it is. But you need to know that precision does not trump accuracy. You can measure and get the wrong value over and over and over and over and over again, right? And you can have a very good R-merge or R-measured, whatever. And Charles Whelan in his book last year said, no amount of precision can make up for inaccuracy, okay? And I was at the ACA meeting. There's only a couple of people who were at the ACA meeting. But let's have Vijay stand up and do this trick, please. If we were measuring his height, right, how tall is he right now? Okay, I know that. Let's say he's 6'2". How tall are you? He says yes, right? So if I measure this over and over and over and over again, I get 6'2½", right? Over and over and over. I get a great R merge. So what's wrong with my measurement? He's got shoes on, right? So please have a seat. So let's say his shoes is an extra centimeter bump in height. I just measured it completely wrong. It's completely inaccurate, but I've got a very good R merge on measurement. And so that kind of tells the tale of accuracy and precision. And you must have very accurate data to do something like sulfur saturation. So you have to be thinking in your experiment, and do a good experiment, essentially not to introduce systematic errors when you do your experiment. Okay? So the moral of that is, don't wear shoes when you're collecting X-ray diffraction data. Is that right? Okay. So these were the steps you saw before, and I'm just going to concentrate on the image processing right now, and somebody else will talk about scaling. As Bishop will talk about scaling, in fact. So I hope he subtracts off the background, which is his shoes, right? So your goal is to have a set of, at the end of the day, a set of scale HKL marked intensities and sigmas. So what you do is you're converting images into what we'll call Bragg reflections. You're going to find spots and get their positions on the detector and during the course of the experiment, how you rotated the crystal. You're going to index, and I've given you the math or the linear algebra for this, so that you'll get the crystal unit cell, and you'll also get how it's oriented. But that's just that's a rough guess coming from indexing. You'll do refinement to actually minimize the differences between the predicted positions of your spots and the observed positions of your spots. And you'll adjust the parameters or the properties of the crystal detector and source in order to get that. But once you have that, you can predict where all the spots will be in your experiment, with a few caveats, okay? And we'll talk about some of the caveats at the end. But you can also estimate a strategy that you would like to use and collect. Integration, then, is basically predicting where all the spots are and summing up the X-ray photons in each of the spots in an elegant way to increase both the accuracy and precision. Remember, we just talked about that, of your spots, because then you can go on and use that for phasing and to get an electron density map and build a model, write your paper. For the students, you get to graduate. Don't forget, you're trying to get out, and away you go. So back to this. What I wanted to show you here is that we have a few slides now coming back to indexing. If you don't know the detector position, if you don't know where this direct beam hits the detector and how the detector is oriented, you cannot do indexing very well, okay? So who's had a problem indexing in this? All right, I'm glad to see that my talk may help some people, all right? But those who solved their problem in indexing, all the same hands went up, right? Everybody's successful. So how do you get the direct beam position? And this is just some practical idea. So here, can we see the red cross in the back? Can you see it? All right, thank you. Because they get smaller and smaller on the subsequent slides. You can do a direct beam shot. You can just move the beam stop out of the way and shoot into the face of your detector and see where that is. You can use powder rings or ice rings. And so you can see these ice rings here. And the center of these rings should be where the direct beam is. You can also use symmetry, which I'll show now. I have a few slides showing symmetry. Maybe you can't recognize it. Do people see any symmetry in that? Okay. I put an arrow here. There's a twofold along that arrow. And so the spots on the left-hand side and the right-hand side are pretty much the same, especially at low resolution. And you can actually count the number of reciprocal lattice rows. And this is like one row off, and this is like halfway past it, and that's the right. Okay, so too hot, too cold, just right. This is a way of getting the direct beam position using symmetry. Now, I didn't mention this, but most of you will already implicitly know this, that if you have a beam stop in here, which is the shadow, the direct beam is likely to be behind the beam stop, right? Right? Just say right. All right, got it. All right. Now, the detector distance can affect the beam position because as I move my detector back, and I'll use this gong, and if this was a real gong, it would weigh many more tons than this guy, right? As you move him back away from the, let's say the x-rays are coming in like this, as you move him back, he's on a longer moment arm and he'll sag, right? Or he'll tilt or something like that. So measuring the direct beam at one position doesn't necessarily mean it's that same direct beam further back. And it could, or the x-ray source could be coming in on parallel or at an angle, and the detector translation may not be collinear with the source vector. And all of that will change your direct beam position. And this is why, you know, somebody may say, well, I measured the direct beam at 100 millimeters. It's nowhere near there at 400 millimeters. Okay, so just think about that. And I think next I have a case of that. This came out of the ACA has meetings as a session on data processing with the pros. And if you look at this, there's a faint outline of a beam stop here, and the red cross is just on the edge of the beam stop here. And so in terms of indexing this pattern, this is the direct beam that was given to you. So what you can do is, if you superimpose several images, I hope you can see there's a line that goes through here like this, and the beam is not symmetric with respect to these two spots and these two spots. Can you see that? Okay. So I've superimposed it, and if I put the beam in the center here of these two, that makes the whole thing absolutely trivial to index. All right? So I'm using, in another way, I'm using symmetry to do this. Who has used symmetry to get the direct beam position? Dominica, gentlemen, I don't know your name, but we'll call you Dominica too, okay? So, just a few people. So who's going to use symmetry in the future? All right, a whole bunch more hands. All right, there you go. All right, my work is done. I taught one tip here. So because I'm talking about indexing and I have plenty of time left, I will talk about finding spots. Generally, what people do to find spots is they just click. And they get some spots, and they're happy. But there's some logic to this. You can find spots from one or more images, and I'll talk about that. The goal here is to get good 3D positions for that TS vector that I talked about, so you can back project onto the reciprocal, onto the Ewald sphere, in order to calculate the scattered beam wave vector S, so that you can calculate the D star vector. And people use criteria in the programs are I over sigma of the spot, the minimum pixel values. Maybe I only want to use things with photon counts above 100 or 1,000 or whatever. I want to exclude non-Bragg spots like from ice rings or other odds and ends, detector defects and so on. It's okay in my experience to use saturated spots, the spots that have blown out the linear range of the detector. There are reasons to use low-resolution spots or high-resolution or all of them, and I might talk about, I think I have a slide talking about that. You can actually filter the spots based on their size and shape so that you can exclude salt diffraction or zingers. And another thing is spots near the spindle, near the rotation axis, you do not know their rotation value very well. It doesn't matter if you've collected 5-degree images or 0.1 degree images. The spots are grazing the Ewald sphere, and they extend out to both inside and outside the Ewald sphere for quite a distance when they're close to the rotation axis, and that gives you a higher level of uncertainty. And most programs will exclude the high Lorentz or those spots from indexing. So if you're using one image, to index. It's not affected by the wrong spindle rotation. So some beam lines, they forgot to tell you whether they're rotating right hand like this or right hand like this or this or this. They're always rotating right-handed, just so you know. Nobody ever uses their left hand in the math inside these programs. You're less affected by a moving crystal. So if you put your crystal up, or the robot puts the crystal up, as it warms up the base, it can actually shift because of the thermal expansion coefficient of the metal and so on. And that first image, that when you get it up there, it can be moving quite a lot, so much that you may have to recenter. But still, with one image, once everything is fixed, it's collected in a very short time. The crystal doesn't have much of a chance to move. You have more uncertainty in the spot angle because you haven't sliced that Bragg reflection into multiple images. And maybe you don't have enough spots, you know, especially if it's a small molecule and you only have a few spots. So you might have to use multiple images. On the other hand, multiple images, if the crystal is moving or the goniometer is not well described, it's deadly, because especially if you're looking after the fact. Maybe you collected 180 degrees of images. You want to use the first two images, maybe some images in the middle, and maybe some images at the end. The indexing programs, most of them are assuming that the crystal orientation is the same at the beginning, the middle, and the end. And if the crystal has moved, it's not the same, and this causes difficulties with indexing. So if you have difficulty with multiple images, try to use one image at the beginning, or one image in the middle, or a couple of images adjacent to the middle. With multiple images, you can also get a better spindle or phi angle observation. It looks like these blackboards are never used here. Is that true? Here we go.
Here we go.
Whoa. All right. So if I have several images here, you can see that if I found a spot in this image right here, I would probably say that that's the center of it. That's the only one I measured, right? If I only measure that image, I would just say that's the phi angle. If I measured this guy, I would say that's the phi angle. This would be a weak spot that I would measure. And if I measured several adjacent images, I can actually get the peak value or estimate the center of intensity of this. And so this is what I'm saying here. You get a better spindle or phi angle determination by using multiple adjacent images. Start and widely spaced or contiguous. If I've collected the data and I know the crystal is stable and the diffractometer is not moving well described, I would probably use widely spaced images. Okay? So finding spots. If you have split crystals and so on, you can do things like use a center of mass of several satellites. You can try to do a cutoff where the high intensity spots only pick ones with the highest intensity. You can go in and edit your list, add peaks, subtract peaks. All of these things can be used. Okay? Indexing. I just want to talk about Fourier indexing, and this comes from Ingo Steller, Robert Bolotovsky, and Michael Rossman, and I think something similar has been used in Denso for a while, although they may do 3D. This is kind of like a 1D indexing. So here's what happens in indexing, at least in D Star Trek and some other programs. You get the S vector, the scattered beam wave vector, from the position of the spot on the detector, knowledge of the detector position and the rotation angle of the crystal. You calculate D star by adding S naught to here, normalizing, and so on. So you know what D star is for a list of all the spots that you found. Next, you're going to take a test direction, T, and see if the spots are ordered along T. And what this is, oh, look at this. I have a set of ordered reciprocal lattice microphones. Thank you. Okay? So if I have a test direction along here, say in this direction, all these microphones, if I calculate the dot product with them, so let's say these are my four microphones, and I project down onto this test vector by doing a dot product, I can do a histogram for that. And so I'll get this histogram, and I can then do a Fourier transform on. The origin peak will be high, but the peak here, depending on how ordered these are, will be higher and higher. And so if I do these projections, I will know where principal axes will be. So in contrast, if I take another direction of the same lattice, and I've tilted this a little bit, and I do the dot products, I'll get a histogram like this. When I calculate the 1D Fourier transform, the peak will be here, will be lower. And this distance here, the position of this peak, tells me something about the spacing found in the order here. So what happens in these programs is they calculate a hemisphere of guesses, of these T vectors. So I'm in that direction, that direction, that direction, that direction, all the way over. And then I start like this, and away I go. I won't zap this into your eyes, so I would have to if I was an index. So the thing here is, you guys know what a golf ball looks like. It's like you're testing all these dimples on the surface of your reciprocal lattice. And in the program that we wrote, and I think also in this paper, they save the top 30 directions with the most order. And you can see that if you have some eye spots in here, it will affect this only a little bit because of this Fourier filtering that you're doing. Then you take those top 30 things and you try to figure out what are the basis vectors. And you have to do many combinations to get something that's right, and there's a whole bunch of other things going on in there. But from that, you'll get this table that many of you have seen of either the 44 lattice characters or the 14 Bravais lattice types. So you have to remember here, you need the detector position to calculate the S vector, so that means all the translations and all the rotations. You don't want to use non-Bragg spots, such as Zinger, salt, or ice rings. And you just have to get within the radius of convergence of the refinement program, which we'll talk about in a second. You'll get the primitive reduced cell basis. And this is basically an idea of this. The way to think about this is it gives you the smallest three-dimensional repeating solid that describes your lattice. You fit these to a primitive reduced cell basis vectors to the 44 lattice characters. You watch out because lower symmetry could be masquerading as higher symmetry. For example, something could be monoclinic, but the beta angle could be 90.1. And I'm not going to describe all of the crystal systems, but the indexing may say, oh, that's orthorhombic. And then knowing the Bravais lattice type or the lattice character doesn't define the space group, right? So I found this on the web, a couple of sites here, and this just shows graphically what I'm talking about here. If we have a lattice of green dots, this rectangle describes a lattice with the smallest area solid, if you will. Smallest area, that's an oxymoron, isn't it? Anyway, the smallest area here. And other lattices that could describe repeatingness are, for example, you can see that the red lattice has an intervening spot here. The blue lattice has something in the center. You could have centering the magenta lattice, but this is the right lattice. And this shows the 14 Bravais lattice types that you have in the 7 crystal classes. And I know that if you're a molecular biologist, you grow your crystal, you do this, you mount it, away you go, you see spots. You don't have to know any crystallography until you see that page that pops up and says, select a unit cell, right? And you go, oh my God, what does rhombohedral mean? I have no clue, all right? Well, you'll still have no clue after this lecture. I'm sorry. You have to go look that up in the book, all right? And some of this stuff is still tricky. So even though Nick Sauder and Ralph Grosser-Kunzlev and Paul Adams, you know, wrote about this stuff, every so often there's another paper that shows up about indexing and cell reduction. In fact, one just appeared this year, and I saw Larry Andrews and Herb Bernstein last week. And just note, this is a quote out of the paper, failure to correctly identify the Bravais lattice screws you. Okay? That's a direct quote. All right. So I want to iterate again. What if the beam position is wrong? If the beam position is wrong, maybe we shift the beam down here so the relative spot position looks different. The scattered beam wave vector gets calculated wrong. The scattered beam wave vector is wrong. The reciprocal lattice point is wrong. Everything is wrong, and you're in trouble. A manifestation of that you can check later, here's like a large unit cell. They had the beam position wrong, and you see these blue circles? He says no, he says yes. Okay, yes. Do you see they're not on the spots here? You can guess that this is a four-fold screw axis. If you know something about four-fold screw axes, they give rise to systematic absences, so only every fourth reflection is here. you can see it's not predicted right, but when you get the beam center right, it's predicted properly. This is just a check that you can make, especially for large unit cells. You can go looking for this. Refinement is just running these linear equations, minimizing the differences between the predicted spot positions and the observed spot positions. You can calculate the derivatives of all of this and run the math, and that's what the programs do. In D-Star Trek, if you do a refinement, the blue spots are the spots accepted, the red are rejected. This is bad. It's not refined well because you have an anisotropic distribution of accepted spots. And I think the same goes for all the programs. This is good. Almost all the spots are accepted. And you can see I've excluded low resolution spots here. This is the spindle is horizontal here. So the blind region, there aren't many spots here. This is a good refinement and so on. So that's a trick. So in refinement, do you use every image, groups of images? Is the crystal moving unpredictably? Then you can't use a single set of parameters to describe the experiment. Is the crystal goniometer described accurately to the software? Is the crystal goniometer mechanically accurate? And I know the Dials folks are working on things here to address this. But in many of the programs, you assume that you've done a good experiment because the math inside requires it. The crystal mosaicity, this is an ideal crystal. This is your crystal. And you've done a weird job freezing. It has extra stuff coming off at the low end. If you have a neighbor, maybe it's weak and it's in the kind of trashy stuff here. This is the Trevor Greenhuff and John Helliwell equation. And just to give you an idea here, here's a predicted mosaicity with blue. Here's the actual diffraction image. It's an old image. The mosaicity is described as too small for the program, and you're not predicting that spot. On the other hand, the mosaicity here is over-predicting, and we're predicting that a spot lies here and here when it doesn't. And if we integrate that, we'll integrate noise, and then it's just right. And I used to give a talk, and I would say it's the Goldilocks. It's too hot and too cold, but then I found out that most people don't know the story of Goldilocks and the Three Bears anymore, right? And the Asian students can't tell me what the equivalent is in Chinese. And I'm still, so come and talk to me later about that, and then I can add that to the talk. Anyway, get the mosaicity right. In the last 10 minutes, we'll integrate quickly. It's just predicting where the spots are, put the box around the reflection, assign peaks to the, or pixels to the peak and to the background, sum the peaks, subtract the background, and away you go. This is a series of slides from Mark Prescrich he showed. You're really projecting that reciprocal lattice space onto the detector space. And if you look at this, this goes back to the Ewald sphere. Here's the center of your crystal, the center of reciprocal lattice. As this moves through the Ewald sphere, you get something on the detector. And because this spot is spherical, you get kind of a sphere ellipse here with the angle. As it moves in, you get a different shape. As it moves through, you get a different shape. And so can you see that the three shapes are superimposed here? And they're different, okay? They're different. And they're moving and so on. So I have a slide from Elspeth Garman that I got from Phil, and I don't know where you got it from, but maybe you got it from me, you know, and so it all comes around. So I have a series of these. This is showing the same thing that you saw here. If you had collected a large 1-degree image or a 2-degree image, you would have one intensity profile. If you slice it up, you get smaller intensity profiles. This is showing more curved on the Ewald sphere. Sometimes the spots are full, fitting in one image. Sometimes they'll be partial. Sometimes you have larger ellipses and smaller, and you can see that you get different data, and there's different ways of processing this. From Bob Sweet, consider a high mosaic crystal and a low mosaic crystal here. And this shows the math and some of the background and the standard error propagation. The orange is the value that we want. The orange plus green is the value that we've measured, so we have to estimate what the background is in green, using the neighbors, either on the front side, the back side, or around, and subtract it away. That's what this background is. And clearly, with a sharp crystal, the background underneath here is a smaller area than this area, so the background is lower. We still are estimating the background from either side here, and so on, and we still want the area under the peak. So what we do is we do the prediction running this equation. We calculate the rocking curve, which I showed you. We correct for the Lorentz factor, which is the time spent in the diffracting condition. There is a polarization factor, And this comes from Wolfgang Koch's program, and Kai is in the audience. I think I had a typo here, and he caught it one time. So we'll go on? No. In any event, the probability of diffracting in certain directions is higher at some beam lines and in some instruments, and this accounts for that. And then you have these oblique incidence correction factors, which some people may call parallax factors. And what I wanted to show you is that there's this paper available to read about this from Zaleski, Wu, and out of Phil Coppin's lab. And there's two types of correction factors, depending on what's happening here. So as X-rays come in from the left here, you can have a window here that blocks X-ray photons, say a beryllium window, aluminized mylar paper, and you can see that if you're coming in at an angle, you pass through more thickness. Does that make sense, the way I've drawn it? So you actually lose photons. On the other hand, in the greenish area, you have a phosphor or maybe silicon. And as you pass through here, you have a certain thickness of the phosphor you're going to pass through. But if you go through at an angle, you go through more of the phosphor. So there's more of a chance for a conversion of your X-ray photon into something that counts in your detector. So these kinds of things have to be corrected for in integration. And you have to know these. Your detector has to be calibrated. A word on background. So this is a superposition of several images. I'm going to try to integrate that spot right there. And this shows that spot right here. But I have six panels. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. For six images in rotation. You guys got that? It's six images here. So this spot is not on the first image. Maybe a hint of it on the second image. It's passing through the Ewald sphere in the third and the fourth image. Slowly goes away and is gone. There's neighboring spots here. So we have to assign pixels to the peak, and I've made them a darker gray, pixels to the background, this shade of gray, and pixels that are in neither peak nor background. And you can say, do I use 2D background in this image for this pixels, 2D background in this image for this pixels, or do I use 3D background? Do I do a plane fit? Do I use pixels before, after? And the various programs do various things. And there's still room for development to do interesting things there. So in HKL, this shows the X Display F program, and you have spot radius, background radius, and box size. So the box size gives you in purple where you're going to estimate the background from. The background radius in green says I'm going to exclude these pixels from that background calculation, and I'm going to use the pixels that intersect the orange to do profile fitting and estimate the intensity of that spot. You must mask out the neighboring pixels and so on. And you can see that if you had a zinger right here in the purple area, that might affect the background, right? Or if you had thermal diffuse scatter or something like that, there's, you know, bits and bobs of stuff out here are going to go into the program, and you can do things. The various software packages have ways of doing that. So to finish up quickly here, we're going to do something called profile fitting. There's two major assumptions. The reflections have the same profile, which means they have the same shape and the same intensity distribution within that shape. So here's a profile. It's stronger on the left side than on the right side. Maybe I have another reflection. It's the same profile. The only difference here, and here's a third reflection that's weaker. It's the same profile. It's just that everything is scaled on a pixel-by-pixel basis. So if I have a value for this pixel and a value for the red pixel like this, the ratio of the lengths of these two arrows is some factor. I'll call it 2.5. If I go somewhere else on the profile, the ratio of these two vectors is also the same, 2.5. So they have the same shape and the same distribution in that shape, same start and end. And you must predict the reflections accurately. So going back to that refinement, if you're not predicting accurately, the profile fitting isn't going to work very well. Bad predictions give you a bad reference profile, which is made by summing up profiles of nearby strong reflections. And you can see that if I sum these, it's not the same as I had on the previous slide. Well, okay, we'll skip. And it shows here, so you'll get good. So you must have things accurately predicted. If you are going to do a least squares fit of a observed profile to the reference profile, you can say, oh, what's the scale factor to get the reference profile, multiply it to get this. And you can see if I multiply this by this, subtract it, it should go to zero if I'm doing a proper fitting. And I can calculate the derivatives of this, and I can get a scale factor. And if we make this scale factor something interestingly named like intensity, we can directly get the intensity out of this. This shows a precession photograph, and can you see that the spots, even this spot over here has the same shape as this spot over here? Can you see that? And even though there's some weak spots here, they have the same intensity distribution of the strong spots. So this is what profile fitting is about. So to talk about how to select the best box, where are the neighboring reflections? They're known from prediction. What are the spot sizes? They're best known from fitting. And I would set my box size to be big enough to estimate the background around that spot, but not too big because the background from this spot is not from over here. So let's say the background from this spot doesn't need information from over here. And so in HKL, you can see the effect here. These boxes might be too big. Do you need to mask out the shadow of the beam stop? And the answer is yes, because the programs may or may not do a good job. And in this case, these spots here that are in yellow are accepted. Even though they have low pixel values, they have the background slope is not rejecting them, and other programs reject things with a low standard deviation. So some tips. Set the detector position so the spots don't overlap. Set the wavelength so the spots don't overlap. Set the rotation angle increment so the spots don't overlap. Set the beam divergence so the spots don't overlap. Often folks make a rotation angle too wide. I think that's less of a problem now, and you'll see Clemens talk about that in a moment. Make sure the crystal isn't moving. Make sure everything is, all the bolts, nuts and bolts are tight. Make sure the cryostream doesn't vibrate the crystal. Make sure the beam isn't moving. And in a home lab, the beam may fluctuate as the temperature in the room changes, and you may have to correct for that. For large unit cells at a beamline, use a lysozyme or other test crystal to determine accurately what the position of the detector is, which includes all of these things. And when things go wrong, you can call people up and ask for help. So summary, I talked about the beam center, the distance, finding spots, a little bit about the background, the mosaicity, pays to think. Don't just click the buttons. Experience counts. Use lysozyme to practice and do sulfur SAD phasing. And I had some acknowledgments, and I guess I'm 30 seconds over. I stop right now. Thank you very much.
Anybody have any questions?